thank you very much for coming. And I want to build on what Jeff was saying, but also I want to expand out a little bit and look at what was happening in Hurricane. It's going to be hard to. I want to build on what Jeff was saying, but I also want to talk about Hurricane Hole and the mangroves and show you what happened in there. After Irma, I was really afraid to look. I did not want to go out and look at what was going on underwater. And after all the previous hurricanes I've been through, usually I've been able to get out and go scuba diving or snorkeling like a week or two after the storms. And in this case, I really just was fearful of what I was gonna see. And in fact, I didn't get out. There's still several places that I regularly snorkel that I haven't been to. So this is just, to Jeff's earlier point, we have not even gotten to all of the sites that we're familiar with. I really hope this looks familiar to all of you. Once again, echoing what Jeff said, I believe that because we have a national park here and we have a national monument here, we have a better chance of seeing these natural resources recover. Natural resources is kind of a jargony term, but what do we mean? We mean the forests, we mean the mangroves, we mean the coral reefs. But I think that because we have this is a small island, but we have a monument and a park, and that gives us a better chance of seeing recovery. Okay, what happened? You got a sense of what happened from some of the pictures that Jeff showed. Some of these corals were buried, some of them were toppled, some of them were fragmented, and some that because I spent quite a bit of time going out snorkeling, taking pictures, that kind of thing, there were actual corals that I went to look for, and they were just gone. They disappeared. I didn't even find fragments. And what we know less about is what happened to the anemones, and I'm happy to say that every time I've snorkeled, I've seen at least one octopus. I don't know what the heck, they must have really gone down deep to hide. But anemones and things that somehow managed to survive these really powerful storms. Here is an area in Leinster Bay, close to what Jeff was talking about with the three buoy area that he showed. And several of you here, I know, are fond of this place and have snorkeled here many times. This finger coral was just scoured away. And one of the things that I have found a little disorienting, literally, is that some of the places I'm really familiar with and that I love are unrecognizable to me. This particular coral, as Jeff said, we don't have, it seems strange, but there is not that much information on coral growth rates. This one, finger coral, will grow a little bit faster than some of the others. And this area might look a lot better in 10 or 15 years, but it was just scoured clean. I kept looking around and I kept thinking I was in, the wrong place. Also in that same area where the three buoys are, you can see in the upper left, there's a nice fish. Pillar coral over here, the star coral over here. I can't find any of that pillar coral now. I've been back several times and I don't even see it. And the star coral out there has now toppled over. There's these columns lying on the bottom. So there's severe damage in some of these places. This is also echoing one of Jeff's points about the importance of structure. This Nassau grouper is up against this rock and the finger coral in the front, and I know you can't see. This little guy is a clean-eating shrimp. I know you can't see that. You might be able to see the spotted moray there. They're all there because that structure is there. This is what it looks like now. There's nothing there. Doesn't mean it can't grow back, but it's not providing habitat for fish. Some corals were just moved around, they were detached. This one in another storm comes along, and this coral can be flipped over, moved. I wouldn't expect it to survive. another example of pillar coral. Some of you actually know this beautiful colony. And off to the right, obviously, almost all the columns were broken off, but there was some healing that has begun very, very slowly, but it's still, and the corals that are still attached at the base, they really have a chance to keep growing. Elkhorn coral in Francis Bay. There's not a great deal of elkhorn coral. This is another one of the corals that's listed as threatened under the Endangered Species Act. This, now there's nothing but the base. The base is all that remains here. This, I took this picture last Sunday, snorkeling with friends in Haulover Bay. That is what shattered elkhorn coral looks like. But that coral, those pieces, and it's important to remember, this coral, these corals have been adapted to storms for a long time. But the question becomes, how much can they take? What is the tipping point when you have warming waters and other stressors coming in? But those fragments, because they landed on something hard, can actually attach and grow. When they land in sand and they're moved around by all the seas, and they won't survive. In the mangroves in Hurricane Hole, some corals just sort of disappear. You know, some are partly damaged. You can see this coral is missing now. And all these little sponges and other growth on the crop roots, it's just gone. And this is partly damaged. So Hurricane Hole is an absolutely fabulous place. Very narrow mangrove fringe, red mangroves growing around the edges of these bays. And they support an amazing biodiversity. Coral, sponges, sea squirts, all these other things. Biodiversity is kind of a jargony term. It just really means variety, diversity. And there were 30 different species of corals on or near the roots. As far as I know, that's unique in the Caribbean. I don't know of any other place in the Caribbean where there are mangroves that support this amazing number of coral species. I mean, there's several right here. That's a different one than this. They're pretty amazing. Here's just some examples. I decided to throw in a little bit of Coral 101 for all of you. And some of the people I snorkel with still don't know what these things are, and I've decided to use this opportunity to teach them. The boulder coral, finger coral, mustard hill coral, rain corals and star corals. These are maybe 2 to 3 feet across, but several decades old. I mean, they just grow very, very slowly. Boulder rain coral, groove rain coral, flower coral. This is one of the ones that normally would grow a little bit deeper, and probably is growing in Hurricane Hole because of the shade of the mangrove trees. Lettuce coral is here, and fire coral up here.
Are these all pre-storm?
These are all pre-storm, these pictures, and I'm sorry to say many of these are not there anymore. This is a quiz. You can turn in your answers later. It's not really fair because I didn't tell you what this one is. This is rough scarlet coral, and actually that Sideroastrea siderea is showing up in a lot of places. It seems to have done better than a lot of the other coral species. This particular coral is, it has a stupid name of cactus coral, but we're stuck with that. It's usually found in deeper water, and I think once again, because of the shade of the trees, it has been growing in shallow water. That one, there were only two or three individuals of this species, and I believe that they're all gone. So this is one, in most places, we have all the pieces that we had before. But in some cases, we have, like in Hurricane Hole, I don't think this species probably can be found again. doesn't mean it can't eventually settle and grow back, but, so we have a lot of what we had, most of what we had before, but we have less of it. In this particular case, we may have lost this species. There's about 80 different species of fish in the mangroves. No, I did not put a mirror between these two. One interesting thing is that I've seen almost no angelfish around, and they eat over 90% sponges. So, and the sponges were very hard hit. Snappers. There are about 60 species of sponges. A lot of the color and texture that you see when you're snorkeling in Hurricane Hole is from sponges. I still don't have the guts to go night snorkeling in this place, but anyway. Other marine life, we usually focus on the corals and the fish for a lot of good reasons, but we still have a lot to learn about the, we haven't even really cataloged everything that we find in Hurricane Hole. Several other anemones, coral morphs, different marine life that I can't tell you yet how these did during the storms. Lobsters, shrimp, conchs, even some hawksbill turtles. Hawksbill turtles eat primarily sponges. And I know that you've seen at least some turtles around the island. I suspect that they're probably doing pretty well, but I haven't seen any hawksbills so far. Okay, here's an aerial of Hurricane Hole, and the arrows show where I took a couple of videos that I hope will play. This is an area that is one of my favorite spots in there. Those of you who have been on my friend's seminar field trip have been there with me. That's usually our first stop. And I went, and I was in February, I went back, and I was really kind of horrified to see what had happened in there. And then I went back in March with the Park Service while they were doing a huge, I have to say, the amount of work that's been done on this island has been off the chart, and by the Park Service and all sorts of other people. But I went out there with Thomas Kelly and others, and Rick, and I did a video on the other side of Water Creek, and I was somewhat encouraged by what I saw. So here is a fairly harsh example of what it looked like before in some areas, Water Creek, and then after. And what you see is a lot of these rocks going up into the properties. Now, I don't know how that's going to affect red mangrove seedlings. Are the seedlings going to be able to get established in some of that? I don't know. How are those crop roots ever going to be covered? They should eventually be covered again, but it's going to take some time. Jeff, do you know how to make this? Is he here? I'm hoping this will play for you. Don't go anywhere because there's too much. So here we have examples of it's a little seasick here. Brain corals, finger corals, French grunts. This is all before, this is about a year before these storms. Queen angelfish in the back there. That gives a pretty realistic effect of bouncing around in the water. Yeah. Okay, the idea there. Hey, I'm not seeing where you're pressing. This one. Don't go too far. This is what I saw in February 12th. And this was probably my lowest day since the storm's out. It looks like, and first let me make sure that you understand that not all of Hurricane Hole looks like this, but more of it looks like this than I want to think about. A lot of these rocks were there and they've been moved around, and it looks like a black and white movie now. This was really tough. Okay, the other one that's not cooperating right now just showed that on the other side of Water Creek there were some large reef corals, and it made me feel a little bit encouraged. I saw more sponges there, and so not everything it looks like that one video that I showed you. I don't want to leave you with that impression, but it has changed dramatically out there. And when you're snorkeling, you have to be careful not to bump into trees or drive over them in your boat. Everybody who's been on the island in the last few months has noticed the condition of the red mangroves. They look absolutely terrible, and in fact, some of those are just not going to, they are not going to recover. So we're dependent on these seedlings that you see here. Some of these have survived the storm. And I was talking to Ken Krause, who I work for the U.S. Geological Survey, and he is a USGS mangrove expert. I asked him about how long it might take for some of these seedlings to reach the height of the trees that they were at the time of the storm, and he said about 10 to 12 years to get about 25 feet. These aerial photographs, I think, really pretty dramatically show what happened in about, 4 hours of time. We saw our world transform, and we saw this horrible, horrible damage to the boats. We saw everything turn around, and we saw the water quality go really deteriorate, and that lasted for a long time. But I think that, once again, what we don't see up there is a lot of development. We don't see sewage plants. I went snorkeling in American Samoa years ago, and there was a tuna cannery there. I mean, it was, here we do have a chance, because of the park and the monument, we do have a chance of reducing those other stressors that can delay recovery. But think about it, in the mangroves, we have to have recovery above and below. We have to have the trees there. We have to have the prop roots in good shape. And we have to have a source of larvae. House is the gentleman in the back. He's going to be coming here in July, I hope. The Park Service is providing some funding through a proposal that Jeff and I and others worked on, to get these people to come back and set up to evaluate what happened with mangroves, and also to set up some monitoring plots. We also have some students from Santa Fe College, which is in Gainesville, Florida. They have worked incredibly hard. This is their professor, Matt Kerrigan. Several students and visiting teachers came and stayed at Zubinball, and that is a huge loss. That Zoo Ball was extremely important to us as a place for our scientists to work out of, apart from other losses here. And they went and did very, very detailed surveys in Otter Creek, right in the middle of Hurricane Hole, looking at coral density, prop root density, and they're going to try to come back and resurvey those areas. But you can imagine how difficult that might be, because it's hard to even with GPS coordinates, it's hard to even know where you are. But they're really hard workers, and we will be bringing them back with some of this money that the Park Service is providing. About 10 days ago, my sister was visiting. She and her friend Carrie, and Carrie's daughter Aiden in this picture, she's 12, they were going to come for Christmas, and we postponed their visit. reasons. And they're from Missoula, Montana, and they had never been to a tropical beach before or tropical site. And it was very restorative for me to see their reaction to St. John, because we all know it is still beautiful. It's just tough to see some of the changes. She got to see sea turtles, octopus. She had never snorkeled before. I've never seen anyone take to it so quickly. But it was helpful for me to see that, you know, there are different perspectives. And one thing I do know, we cannot say, we can't predict how fast things are going to recover. We can't. But I can predict that tourism is going to come back a lot faster than a lot of the natural resources. I believe that there is hope, in spite of some of the rather drastic photos I've shown you. I think there is hope. In Fallover, on the north side, I saw much less damage than I expected. The Elkhorn coral got hit pretty hard, but they're in shallow water. I saw fire coral, sea fans, abundant fish, and that was... So just to sort of summarize, as with previous hurricanes in the Caribbean, the damage was patchy. There's some places that were very badly damaged, some that were not damaged too much. We do not, and we never will, have a real understanding of all the wave and wind forces in all the different areas. I mean, we know where the basic path of these storms, but we don't really have a good handle because we don't have the instrumentation for that. But so there are variations in how hard different places were hit. Will things recover to the way they were before? I would say in most cases, probably not. Not for a super long time. And in the case of the mangroves, you need it both above and below. We don't, and the unique coral mangrove habitat, there's no previous studies of that. There's no scientific literature on that type of an ecosystem. We know corals grow very slowly, certainly the fastest growing ones grow a few inches a year. And we don't know where the larvae, the coral and fish are gonna come from to repopulate these areas. If we don't have a good handle on connectivity, how connected are we with the British Virgin Islands? The British Virgin Islands got slammed also. So it's a tough situation. And we do not want to have any more. One thing I'm pretty sure is the earthquake probably didn't do a whole lot of damage underwater, so that we can be grateful for. There could be more storms. We don't want to see that. There could be bleaching and disease episodes. So it's a tough time to be a coral, but there is hope. In Hurricane Hole, there's a lot less shade. The substrate has changed. There's not as many trough roots, and there's been rearrangement of the rocks. But it's time to get out of here. It's kind of hot. So thank you for your attention, and thanks to the Friends of the Park for welcoming me.